I make dice towers. Dice towers are a board game accessory, and they're used to keep dice in a small area. So if, like, if you ever played a board game that had dice in it, like Monopoly or Yahtzee, and if you ever tried playing Yahtzee in an RV with a small table, the dice tend to smash everywhere. So what the dice tower is intended to do is to minimize the footprint of the dice roll. You put the dice in the top, they randomize down and land in a small tray. So when I was in high school, I first saw a friend that had a dice tower. We were inspired to make our own dice tower, and what ended up happening was the bigger is better mentality started kicking in, and once everyone at the game had a dice tower, there was no room left to play. I could only make the dice tower so small as being a high school kid with basically a hacksaw and plywood. I had the idea for dice towers in my head, but I didn't have a solid solution. And then, so fast forward 20 some years later, there's this maker movement and CNC machines and laser cutters are available. And I was inspired to start making things. So after I went to my first maker fair, and I saw people walking around with laser cut boxes, the six-sided boxes, and they had the finger joint. And it was like, wow, that is so cool. I want one. And everyone's like, yeah, I know, it's so cool. And it was like, what's in there? And they're like, they said, there's nothing in there. There was such a strong attraction to having this laser cut box that was glued together that served no function. I already had realized that if I can imagine it, I can make it. So then I started down that journey. I'm also coming from a consumer's point of view, and I'm trying to figure out what is a producer, what is consumer. And as from a consumer's point of view, I think I had been trained into thinking that if I want something, I have to buy it. And everything that I buy all looks the same. When I went to Maker Faire, I was just amazed that everything was unique. Everything was individualized. And I realized that the difference is when somebody comes up to you and says, wow, you have this thing, where did you buy that? I'm like, I didn't buy it, I made it. And that's what really got me thinking about, wow, there's so many things that can be made. It's just gotta get started. I kind of give myself design goals that whether they are necessary or not, it helps me focus on a way to do it. And then if I'm halfway to that and I just discover a better way to do it, then I go in that direction. So I've never seen a wooden dice tower that was milled out of one piece of wood. So I did that a few times, and those are fun dice towers, but they still kind of had the thickness to them, and there was some fragility to it, and it wasn't as small as I wanted it to be. So when I moved over to the laser cutter, I was able to get the size that I wanted. And when you have a tool like a laser cutter in your garage, it's easier to just make it and play with it and say, how can I do better? And also, to me, there's something real about holding something in your hand, feeling its smoothness, feeling its center of balance. And is it top heavy? Does it teeter totter when you roll the dice? So I probably made 20 or 30 prototypes before I converged on the design I have now. I put a lot of engineering time into the dice tower, but then one thing I wanted to do was to hide the engineering in art. So when you see it, I wanted it to be attractive. It works because I had the engineering in there, but when you see it, you see the artwork. As far as what tools that I'm using in the process, I'm trying to only have the laser cutter. I really am enamored with CNC machines and laser cutters. I don't know why it is. I think it's just the idea of rolling in just raw stock. I mean, like going to Home Depot, getting an 8-foot by 4-foot sheet of potential, and then cutting it into something that is something. So I probably stay in that space. I'm trying to reduce my material type. So I'm sticking with acrylic and thin wood. And I'm trying to put as much cost on my my wood vendor. So if I can get the wood in exactly the way I need it, then I can just drop it into the laser cutter, cut it out, and my wife helps me assemble. As far as what skills you need to pick up, what is amazing, I think, with the laser cutter is you don't need to know anything on the laser cutter side, because with the software that I'm using, you literally hit print and then the job goes to the laser cutter. So if you were to draw a circle and hit print, then the laser cutter is ready, and then you press go, and then instead of printing a circle, it cuts a circle. So I use Corel Draw, which is a vector editor, and then everything that I learned was trial and error. Once you have the shape you want, you hit print, it's at your laser cutter, and then it cuts out what you're imagining. I feel very fortunate to have experienced was in junior high, we actually had a woodshop class. And that left a huge impression on me, where it was the first time you kind of think of something on paper, and then you build it, and then you're holding it. So when I got started, I wasn't planning on Dice Towers turning into a business. I like to let things grow organically, start small, and then see what the next step is. A lot of people, when I'm talking to them, they kind of want to start where someone else left off. And I'm thinking, but you need to learn how to get where they got before you can make it better sometimes. Basically, I gave myself a lot of time to start at the beginning and then figure out what I needed to learn as I went. So when I made the first few dice towers with a CNC machine, I was able to finish them, but they just take a long time. It's very loud. And I can make a few of them, but I can't make a lot of them. So that's also why I went to the laser cutter. And with the laser cutter, then there's the idea of, if I can make one, will I be able to purchase material reliably to make more? And there's no way that I could have a laser cutter in my garage if it wasn't made overseas. And the only way to make things affordable is to use standard manufacturing processes, and you have to find the best reasonable cost for things. I've gone to gaming conventions, and when I went to my first maker fair, I'm like, wow, this is it. This is where I need to be. I really like making dice towers and filling a need there, because there's just a lot of design problems with existing dice towers that I'm trying to address. But I'm also looking forward to moving on to other projects. And also, even with the dice towers, I like collaborating with people, getting other people's idea on how the dice tower can be changed and different artwork that people want to see. I did go to Maker Faire with my dice towers, and I was just happy walking around with holding my dice towers. What I like about the idea of having Maker Faires is it's the community experience. What I think every individual needs is you need the collaboration of lots of information, and then people need to go into their little hibernation mode and then focus on an idea and execute through that idea. So what's good about a maker faire is you get to see people doing things that you may not have thought possible, or you may not have considered before. Just seeing examples of things done and things that you might have thought you couldn't do, you see other people doing. I like the idea. I want to show people that I made this thing, if you can make things too. And it might be easier than you think. Making is just very fulfilling. It's kind of, I have a philosophy of the secret to happiness is figure out what makes you happy and then do that. So I've found that making things makes me happy. So that's why I make things. And for me, making something, I don't know why, has such a strong attraction to me, because it feels like you've changed the world, because the world is a collection of things, is kind of how I see it. And when you make something that's never existed before, you've added something to the world and you've changed the world.